Doctor Who, The Sensorites. The Doctor, Ian and Barbara are standing at the TARDIS control console.
Perhaps we've landed on top of something.
Yes.
Or inside something.
The Doctor looks quizzically at Barbara.
Hmm?
Strangers in Space, written by Peter R. Newman. As Susan comes over to join them, the Doctor taps a flickering dial on the console.
This says everything has stopped but the ship.
What do you mean, Barbara, inside something?
Perhaps that's why we still appear to be moving.
By the scanner, Doctor.
Covered with static. Let's try it again, Susan.
The scanner screen buzzes with interference.
That could be caused by an unsuppressed motor.
Yes, or a magnetic field.
Shall we go outside, Grandfather?
No, I shan't be happy until I've solved this little mystery.
I don't know why we ever bothered to leave the ship.
Well, you're still thinking about the experiences you had with the Aztecs.
No, I've got over that now.
There's one thing about it, Doctor. We're certainly different from when we started out with you.
That's funny. Grandfather and I were talking about that just before you came in. How you've both changed.
Oh, we've all changed.
Have I?
Yes,
it all started out as a mild curiosity in the junkyard. And now it's turned out to be quite a great spirit of adventure, don't you think?
Yes. Well, we've had some pretty rough times, and even that doesn't stop us. Oh, it's a wonderful thing, this ship of yours, Doctor. Taking us back to prehistoric times, the Daleks.
Marco Polo, Marinus, and the Aztecs.
Yes, and that extraordinary quarrel I had with that English king, Henry VIII. You know, he threw a parson's nose at me.
What did you do?
Threw it back, of course. Take them to the tower, he said. That's why I did it.
Why? Well, TARDIS was inside the tower.
Of course. That was long before you appeared on the scene. However, now, let us get back to this little problem. Open the door, Susan.
You checked everything, Doctor?
Yes, plenty of fresh air, temperature normal.
Oh, just the unknown, then.
Precisely.
The four travellers turn from the console to face the heavy double doors of the TARDIS as they swing inwards. They walk out and into a dimly lit control room. At one end, two figures are slumped in chairs in front of the instrument panels of a highly advanced flight deck. Ian looks back.
You were right, Barbara. We have landed in something.
It's a spaceship. Close the door, Susan.
Susan turns back to the police box shape of the TARDIS, taking out her key.
Let us be careful. There's been some kind of catastrophe here.
Susan locks the TARDIS door and follows the others as they cautiously explore the spaceship's bridge. They cross to one of the seated figures. It's a humanoid male in a smart pilot's uniform. They gather round as Ian gently lifts the man's head back to examine him. There's no sign of life. He takes the pilot's wrist and checks for a pulse.
Dead.
Susan walks over to the other uniformed figure.
This one's a girl.
The others join her. And this time, Barbara checks for a pulse.
I'm afraid she's the same. Oh, what can have happened? I can't see a wound or anything.
Suffocation, Doctor?
I never make uninformed guesses, my friend, but certainly that's one answer. Oh, dear, dear, dear. What a tragedy, you know. She's only a few years older than Susan.
Grandfather, let's go back to the TARDIS.
Why?
I don't know. I've got a feeling about this,
yes.
I can sense something, too.
You mean that whatever it was killed them could kill us?
Chesterton, have you noticed anything about this watch?
Ian looks at the girl's watch, and the Doctor darts over to the man's body to inspect his watch, too. Ian comes over.
Neither of them are working. These are the non-winding time. A movement of the wrist recharges the spring inside for 24 hours.
Yes, and they've both stopped at about 3 o'clock.
Yes, then suppose we say that they've only just stopped. Now, that would mean the last movement of their wrists would be at least 24 hours ago.
Susan touches the man's hand.
Grandfather, he's still warm. And they've only just died.
It doesn't make sense, does it? But the facts are all here. I think it would be wise if we returned to the ship and left these people. There's nothing we can do for them.
No, we can't even bury them.
Come along, open the door, Susan.
The four friends walk sadly over to the TARDIS, but the pilot suddenly sprawls across the controls. Ian grabs the Doctor's arm.
His heart had stopped beating, Doctor. He was dead.
The man is pointing feebly.
What do you want?
Oh,
Yes?
Over there.
Where, there?
Behind you.
Here?
No, on the left.
What, this?
Yes, that.
This?
Yes.
Ian rushes from the equipment racks with a matchbox-sized device. The man takes it and presses it against his chest. He slowly sits up, recovering at an extraordinary rate. The doctor exchanges incredulous glances with his companions. The man shakes his head as if to clear it, looks round, and suddenly looks panicked. He hands the device to Barbara.
Carol, place this against Carol's chest.
I'm sorry. Carol's dead.
Please, do as I ask.
Barbara looks at a dumbstruck Ian, then goes over to the other body. She bends down and holds the box against the girl's sternum. Carol takes a deep breath, and her eyes flutter open.
Oh!
You were both dead.
Grandfather, what was in that box?
It's a heart resuscitator. When you found us, we were in a very long sleep, but we weren't dead.
Carol stands.
My name is Maitland. This is Carol Richmond, my co-astronaut.
Tell me, are you from the Earth?
Yes.
So are we. How's it looking?
The Earth, do you mean?
Yes. Oh, there's still too much air traffic.
Oh, they got it off the roads, did they?
You might say that, yes.
Barbara and I, we come from London. Tell me, is Big Ben still on time?
What century do you come from? The 21st, perhaps?
No, the 20th.
I see.
What's Big Ben? Well, it's a clock. Near Westminster Abbey.
Yes. You see, the whole lower half of England is called Central City now. There hasn't been a London for 400 years. We come from the 28th century.
Captain Maitland, these people must leave us immediately.
Yes, you will have to.
But there are so many things we want to know.
There's only danger here for you.
Danger?
You must go.
What sort of danger?
It's better that you don't know what happened to us.
But we might be able to help you.
No, no, Barbara. I learned not to meddle in other people's affairs years ago. Now, don't be absurd. There's not an ounce of curiosity in me, my dear boy. Tell me, why are you in danger?
Very well, I'll try to explain. Out there is a planet we call the Sensosphere. The creatures on it, the Sensorites, have always prevented us from leaving this area of space.
You mean they have some kind of power over your craft?
Exactly. But it's not that simple. They not only control our craft, they had some influence over us as well.
Hypnosis, you mean?
No, I do not mean hypnosis.
For what then?
Somehow they have some control over our brains. They are hostile, these Sensorites, but in the strangest possible way. They won't let us leave this area of space, yet they don't attempt to kill us.
What had happened when we found you?
Well, the same thing that's happened many times before. The Sensorites have put us into a deep sleep that gives the appearance of death. And yet they've never made any actual effort to destroy us.
Far from it. We both have very hazy recollections of them returning from time to time to our ship to actually feed us.
Doesn't add up at all.
This is why you must leave us at once.
Yes. The Sensorites may try to prevent you from leaving.
Behind them, unnoticed in the shadows, there is a figure by the TARDIS. A gloved hand tries the door, then holds a flat circular tool crisscrossed by a filigree of wires against the lock.
I can smell something burning. So can I.
You mustn't delay any longer.
I'm inclined to agree with him, Doctor. But surely there's something we can do for you.
No, nobody can help us.
Grandfather, couldn't we take them back with us?
We cannot leave this ship.
You see, there's John to think of, too.
John?
Ian, there is something burning.
Yes, I think you're right. Maitland, you wouldn't have anything shorting, would you?
Oh, no, that's not possible.
At the TARDIS door, smoke is rising from the lock. The gloved hand lowers the circular tool and slides the entire tubular locking mechanism out of a neat hole. But the door still won't open.
Seems to be coming from over here.
You have additional crew, I take it?
Yes.
Doctor, you must go. Leave us.
Well, there seems to me that there's nothing else I can do. Goodbye, my friend. Bye-bye, my child. Come along, Susan.
Bye. It's stronger over here, Doctor.
Oh, perhaps it's coming from inside the tower.
Grandfather!
Good gracious, they've taken the lock.
It's not so much the lock, it's the opening mechanism. The door's permanently locked.
Permanently? But there must be some way of getting in. What can we do, Doctor? Break down the door?
And disturb the field of dimensions inside the TARDIS? We dare not. Well, we've been most effectively shut up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.